Welcome, friends, to this short one-day meeting in Austin, Texas. I'm very happy to be here to see all of you, to meet some old friends, I recognize some new friends, but all friends. Our friendship comes from a different source. Friendship is not because you have met. Friendship is because we have long ago, one time, shared one soul. We are all soul mates in the real sense. All came from one source, one soul, one totality of consciousness, one creative power. All of us were part of that. So that is why we are all friends. We left each other for some time, for adventure. And the current adventure on which we are here is just a visit to this planet, planet Earth. This planet has many forms of life and lot of life, unbelievable life. I've been to the desert, hot sand, nothing there, no trees. They dug up a little sand and some little insects crawled out from there. And I said, even there, life is hiding inside. Life is in so many forms. Large part of life is today underwater, in our oceans. People are thinking when we run short of food, we'll be able to mine all the algae and other high protein food that lies at the bottom of the ocean. All living plants, living insects, living birds, mammals, angels, gods, creative powers, so many forms of life. According to our Indian scriptures, they have listed a number. They say there is 8.4 million forms of life. Jurassic Park, 8.4. And they listed more than half of that is in the plant kingdom. Maybe 5.6 million, maybe 5.4 or 5.6 million is listed in that long list of forms of life to be in the plant life. And then there are other forms of life, rodents and snakes and little insects and bacteria and all kinds of very small forms of life. Then there are bigger forms of life. Birds, mammals. Then there is a group of the last 400,000. And those are supposed to be the top. In that, human being is listed as one form of life. So you can imagine how much life is there. All this life came from one source, but became the many. Instead of one, we became many. So we are sitting so many here, and there's so many on the planet. We became many so that what was our original nature can be experienced in different environments, different ambiances. Our original nature has been difficult to describe, but has been given a short word called love. L-O-V-E. We say God is love. God, we think, is the original creative power. When they say God is love, that means at one time we were all part of God, we were part of love. If we are all love and only one, it looks like an abstraction. We are love, not lovers, not beloved. How does one love become lover and beloved? By the one becoming the many. whole secret of division and separation arises from the fact that an abstract quality, an abstract function, an abstract experience, which is not being experienced, becomes an experience by the one becoming the many. That is why sometimes we say we have a true home, which is not this created universe, because this is so temporary. When we are in a place which is so temporary, how can we call it our true home? A true home is where we belong forever. From there we can go out, visit some place and come back to our true home. So that is why our true home is where the one and the many coexist, outside of time and space, outside of creation. That is our true home, where we belong. Now, we have had experience of love. There are some other experiences also associated with our own true self, our conscious self. Experiences that need not function in time and space. Time and space is a created thing, just for intention. We don't need time and space in our true home where we are all together, just one. We create time and space in order to have a different experience. That is why we use a little beautiful computer-like device, very good computer-like device called the human mind. The mind is a device that creates time and space. And because the mind creates time and space, its function remains confined to time and space. Main function of the mind is to think. Thinking is a process by which the mind continues to ruminate with language, words, images, whatever it can create, to have a continuous experience in consciousness, in physical consciousness when we are awake, in dream consciousness when we are sleeping, in super consciousness we are in a higher state of being, and in universal consciousness we are in a totality of the universal mind, but it's all in time and space. The mind cannot function. Not even the smallest thought can take place without time. But we, our original self, consciousness pure and simple, life pure and simple, does not need time. Therefore, we are using a device, the human mind, to have a further experience outside of our true home in time and space. So we have come at this moment into a planet called Earth. There may be other planets too. And people are examining where life has come from. They have not found a true answer. The scientists tell us that the life here depends upon a molecule called DNA. The DNA molecule is life. But it need not be any particular kind of life. All life is based upon the same molecule. Through evolution, mutation, we have put more data on that molecule and added more information to that molecule. It's a huge molecule. If we start writing the code to that also four-letter words, not the same four-letter word that we sometimes use in anger. But still, those four-letter words can create so many combinations. And a project going on, the genome project, is trying to write that. And an ordinary one single DNA molecule taken from a one brain cell has taken 200,000 pages just to write it down. The formula contained in there. It's so small, the DNA molecule, every cell in every living thing, in the center contains it. Every cell in our body, no matter what tissue it is, there's a bone, whether it's a muscle, whether it's the skin, whether it's the hair, whatever it is, contains that one molecule. Now, that's so small, it's compressed. If you try to open it and pull it out, you can stretch it without breaking it up to almost 1 inch size. It's amazing. And compress it into so small, it can fit into the center of every cell. What a remarkable thing. It has a double helix and immeasurable capacity for storing data. So it stores all the data of all life at all times. They say that a monkey has almost the same DNA human beings have, 99.9%. And if you take a chimpanzee, 99.9%. If you take a banana, just a fruit, a banana has 50% of the same DNA as a human being. So you can imagine every form of life that has ever come is containing the same DNA molecule. Where did it come from to this planet for us to exist, for life to exist? People are speculating. It could not have come just by itself. Was there another place where many of us had a sojourn and we enjoyed it? It could be. We think of life as we see it on this planet. It requires water, it requires air, it requires certain kind of atmosphere. But could there be other planets like ours? There are two laws in mathematics. One is called the law of probability, and one is called the law of averages. We don't know how these laws are operating. Not even mathematicians know, but they operate. They have been tested out millions of times. What is the law of probability? To give a simple example, supposing you have a coin and you toss it. It can come heads or tails. If the coin is completely balanced, the chances of it coming heads or tails are 50-50. 100 times you should throw it, it should be 50 times head, 50 times tail. You try it, it doesn't come like that. It can be 80-20, it can be 60-40, it can be any ratio. 50-50 is very rare. But when the coin is flipped and comes heads, the law of probability says next time the chance of tails has increased. Coin has no consciousness to decide which side to jump. How is it operating? If you do it only 10 times, it can be very variable. 9-1, 8-2, 7-3, anything. If you do it 100 times, it won't be 9-1 or 8-2. It'll go to more than 60-40. If you do it a million times, toss a coin a million times, try it out, it'll be 50-50. How is it possible? Coin has no consciousness, no decision making. This is called the law of probability working. The law of averages, the law of probability creates this. There are institutions rampant in this country called casinos. The casinos are making good money just by using these laws. The law of probability and the law of averages is making them millions. They predict that this will happen like that because of the law of probability. If you use this law of probability to estimate, is it possible that this universe, observed universe, has any other planets like ours? The law of probability says there has to be at least 35,000 more planets exactly like Earth. The law is prevailing here, why would it not prevail elsewhere? If that is so, it's reasonable to assume that there are several planets with life, like ours. We are not alone. And since the evolution takes place in time, and time has been there for quite a time, so therefore there could be many planets ahead of us in their knowledge and technology, and many of us behind us, and many of us are aging out. And if one highly advanced technology is somewhere, we are just moving towards it, but they are born ahead of us, and they decide this planet is no longer worth living, is going to go down, let's go find a good planet. And they use very modern, sophisticated methods of traveling through time and space. They can easily just package a small little package of DNA molecules and create a whole population again. Maybe that's how we got created. Maybe that is how all life came here. And some people are predicting we are warming up this planet, planet will have more earthquakes, we are going to have nuclear warfare and destroy this planet, and maybe we go. If we are technologically advanced, we'll say let's find another place. Right now the scientists' thinking is very limited because they can't go very far and see what is going on. But they can say we're going to settle on the moon, we're going to settle on Mars, small planets around us. The same system. But there are several planets that are like ours under law of probability. Now, all this is speculation. Or is there a way for us who have just come for adventure to discover if there is something out there or not? Is there means within a physical body to go and check out what is happening 2 billion light years away today? Do we have that capacity? Or are we confined to using the 5 senses and living on this planet only? I am going to suggest to you today that this human being carries with it, inside this body, the capacity to go anywhere. Because everything has been created from one source, is spread out from there. And we have generated experiences not further away from ourselves but around ourselves. Therefore, who are we that we can do all this? What is our true nature? What is our true self? If you can discover that, you'll find such great possibilities. Even the possibility to go 20 billion light years away and see what is there in this physical universe and any other universes that we might have created. This is a very big secret that people are not aware, that the experiences we generate in creation take place around ourselves and not somewhere else. Wherever we belong, outside of time and space, the experience has been generated around it. Therefore, if we want to find who we are really, we should go as close as possible to our own self, wherever the self we can feel exists. Right now, we are all sitting in human bodies. In the human body, we feel that the body is the self. There's something in the body giving us life, and therefore, we are moving around. Is the self which we are talking of, the creative power, the ultimate reality, sitting inside and the body is outside of it? Have we built the body around and then the whole world around the body? Could that be true? There is only one way to really examine it. Go deep inside yourself, wherever you feel the self is operating from. Very simple. If you feel that you are a conscious being and have a self, which by the way everybody feels, in fact that's the only direct evidence we have that we exist as a self. We have no other evidence. Other things can all be hallucination, can all be created, but we have no doubt, nobody has a doubt, we as a self exist. And let's say, just examine, let's say the body is not us, we are using a body. Where are we in this body as the self? Simple examination. We look at our body. We've got nice hands and feet, we do, and we walk and we talk. Are we sitting in the hands, feet? Doesn't look like it. Are we asking this question, where we are, from our hands and feet? No, not at all. Are we asking it from our bellies, our legs? No. It does not take very long to come to the conclusion, whatever we are doing is happening in a very small part of this body, called our head. We are thinking from our head, we open our eyes and it's also near the head. We have ears placed near the head. Ears could have been placed on the stomach, on the side of the belly, but they've been placed in the head. Eyes could be anywhere, but you put them near the head. The main perceptions, we are having sense perceptions of seeing and listening, smelling, tasting, all in this small area, all above the throat. And when we are thinking and asking questions, it's all from our head. We're exactly in the head. If we just examine this for our sense, where exactly do we see things? Where do we hear things? We have two ears. Then, if we have normal hearing, we hear with two ears. Two ears don't hear the same thing. Supposing sound is coming from the left or the right or the left ear hears more of the sound, the other hears less. What happens? We know where the sound is coming from. Can you imagine if we had only one ear, we would never know which direction sound is coming from. Never. Two ears establishes direction. It's amazing that two different levels of sound are coming and we are combining them as one, determining a direction and saying we are hearing only one sound, one word, and we know the direction from where it's coming just because we have two ears. But that means the ear is not hearing that one sound, because ears are separate. Where are we combining the two to know from direction only one sound is coming? Obviously, that combination is taking place in the head, somewhere between the ears. Okay, let's say we are looking outside. We are looking with two eyes. The two eyes don't see the same thing. If you have a finger in front of you and you close one eye, the finger is one place. See with the other one, finger is moved somewhere else. They are not two fingers, but we see two with the two eyes. When we join them together, they become one. Where do we see the one? Not in the eyes. Where do we see the one finger? The whole world we are seeing two pictures at all times. The two eyes can never see the same thing. They are separated. They have used this phenomenon to create 3D movies. They put two images on the screen and they give you special glasses. The special glasses merge the two and we think there's three-dimensional distance has been created. Artificial distance has been created merely by putting two images and combining them through glasses. We are doing the same thing. Two eyes are seeing two different pictures and we are combining them. Where are we combining them? Not at this level, not outside. Combining them inside. Where? At a point, if you carefully examine, same point where we are combining the hearing. We make two different sounds into one. We make two images into one at the same place in the center of the head. Behind the eyes, between the ears, and that point. That notional point in our head, is where we think. Examine carefully. That's where thoughts are coming from. That's where your questions are coming from. Very important point. I would even venture to say that is where the notional self exists at this time. That's where we feel we are operating the body from. Great point. That point, because we combine the two eyes, has sometimes been called the third eye. Third eye center. That point has been called the point. In some Sufi literature, call it the nukta. The point where, from where your consciousness operates. It's a very interesting phenomenon. What I am mentioning to you is that here is a human body we have, and we have one point in this body from where we are operating in wakeful state right now. Therefore, if we have to examine what is the nature of ourselves, who are we? Obviously, the place to examine would be that one point, not anywhere else. Can we go there just to examine? We can't break open our head and go and look what is there. Searchers have done it. They've seen some gland there, the pineal gland and the pituitary body, and they've seen the center, well protected place, most protected place in the human body with a big skull, strong skull. That particular point from where we are operating happens to be the most protected place in the body. Interesting. But when you open up the gray matter of the head, of the brain, and that doesn't reveal where the consciousness is coming from, where life is coming from. Is there any other better way to go and find out what is in the center of our head from where we are operating, where we seem to be existing as consciousness? There is one good way. I'm going to suggest that. And that way is called traveling with your attention. When we use attention, there's a beautiful thing, attention. I don't know if you have understood the nature of attention. We all put attention, we read books attentively, we talk to people attentively, but have we understood the nature of attention? We have a certain facility we call consciousness. What is consciousness? Consciousness means the ability to be conscious or be aware. If you can't be aware, you are not conscious. But if you have awareness, then you can be conscious. But consciousness can be being aware now and then cutting off the awareness, being aware again. I can remember the car I came in from outside and I'm talking to you, I forget about the car. Anytime I like, I can remember the car again. Car is part of my consciousness, whether I'm aware of it or not. So consciousness is potential for awareness. Total consciousness is a total potential for any awareness we like. That's the nature of consciousness. Awareness is limited to what part of consciousness we are using now. We are aware we are sitting in a home. We are aware there are some beautiful flowers on my side. It's our awareness. I am looking at you, but from the corner of my eye, I can see that the flowers are there. I have seen the flowers. I turn this side. I am not seeing the flowers. I am aware the flowers are there. So understand the nature of awareness as a limited part of consciousness, which is part of your awareness, not necessarily of your perception. Sense perception does not show me flowers when I turn here. Awareness is still there. In awareness, we have something else. If I look at the flowers and start looking at the beauty of the rose, say, what, look at the color, I can then put attention. Attention is part of my awareness. I can place wherever I like. I can put my attention on a book. I can put my attention on you. I can put my attention on the flower. I can put my attention on something that is not here. Wherever I put my attention, what happens? My awareness gets concentrated there. This is called concentration of attention. This is a beautiful gift we have got, that we have the power to use part of our awareness called attention and concentrate it wherever we like. In another advantage. If you concentrate your attention on anything, you become less and less aware of everything else. That's a wonderful thing. That means you not only have the power to generate more awareness by using attention, with the power to become less aware of something by putting attention somewhere else. What a wonderful gift we have. That means we can travel anywhere we like for knowledge or awareness. Through this great power of concentrating attention, increasing awareness where we have putting attention, and becoming unaware of other things. This process which we can use in order to discover who we are at the third eye center, in the center of the head, this process we can use by putting attention on the center of the head and concentrating it there. This is called true meditation on the self. What is meditation? To meditate upon something means to think about that, to put attention on that. That's meditation. If we meditate upon the third eye center, which is inside our head, what will happen? If we put our attention there and concentrate it there, our attention will hold whatever we are trying to find there and gradually not think of what is happening outside. We become more and more unaware of what is happening outside. And if we localize our attention behind the eyes, we will not even be aware where our hands and feet are gone. You can try it out. If you put more attention and concentrate it there, you won't even know where the bottom of your body is gone. It appears that when we put attention on the third eye center behind the eyes, we become unaware of the world around temporarily, and also become unaware of our own body. To keep the attention continuously there, we can become completely unaware of our body. Good meditative experience, good meditation to discover what is there. We have brought the awareness there. What will we find? Supposing we do this, we can all try it and see what we find. What are we likely to find? We are likely to find thoughts. Because we are constantly thinking, thoughts will become very clear and loud. And this is what we are thinking all the time. Thoughts will become in front of us. Images will come. Memories will come. Lot of stored information will suddenly come in front of us. Then we will say, these are all coming in front of us. Who is looking at the thoughts? Who is listening to the thoughts? Somebody sitting in third eye center. Who is it? Our own self, then nobody else. We have come so much closer to ourselves with this one exercise. We can make it simpler, much simpler. Because apart from the power of attention that we have been gifted with, we have been gifted with another power. It's called the power of imagination. We can imagine things. I can imagine I am not here, I am standing there. Power is there. Imagination, great power, wherever it's coming from. That's another study I'll recommend to some people who are interested in knowing where these powers come from. They are all coming from within the head, and I'll tell you where they come from. It's a good study. This power of imagination helps us even faster to withdraw our attention to third eye center and become unaware of everything, including our body. We can imagine we are there. Supposing you were imagining I'm sitting on top of this building and put all my attention there, I won't know you are here. Attention will all concentrate there. Why not imagine you're sitting inside the head? We make it even simpler. Because we are so used to thinking this body is our own self, we have to start with imagining body is not our self. We are inside the body. To make that simple, we can use a simple device. We live in our houses. We live in apartments. We can imagine this is a house. The body is a house we live in. And this body has some very interesting structure, which makes it easy to imagine it's a house. It has got energetic levels, level centers of energy located in the body, which have been well described in many yogic exercises. There are six chakras, six centers of energy, starting from the rectum, the genitals, the navel, the heart, the throat, and the eyes. They say these are centers of energy. They generate different circuits of energy and how we experience the world, how we are running our life. These are all energy centers. And since they divide them in different parts, sitting upright looks like a house with six floors. Makes it very easy to do this kind of meditation by imagining that this body of ours is not a body but a house we live in, with six floors. And when we are awake, where are we? Sixth floor, behind the eyes. We can imagine we can go travel down to the lower floors. As it happens, it's very interesting. We can even imagine the ladders going down, but we can more easily imagine there's an elevator at the back called the spine. So look at the perfection of our imagination. A house we live in, six floors. Elevator at the back, along the spine, steps that take bring us up slowly. I've done some yogic practices, in fact many kinds of yogic practices, where you're trained to go travel from the lowest level and travel upwards one by one using different mantras and different words at each stage. I practice that. So I find we can imagine. It's not difficult to imagine that we are in a house where we can go to the lower floor. Or if we are trying to examine who we are, we need not go to the lower floors. We can go just for experiment. But we are awake, therefore we are sixth floor. When we are sleeping, are we still there? No. People don't realize that right now we are feeling, we are looking out from the eyes. Eyes are at the level from where we are thinking. Eyes at the level from where we are awake. When we sleep, do we feel we are still behind the eyes or no? When we are sleeping, we don't know where the body is. So we can't know. But when we are half asleep, we can have a little awareness. Tonight, try it out. When you are about to sleep and just feeling sleepy, do one simple exercise. Close your eyes and touch your eyes with your hands. Right now, anybody can touch the eyes with the eyes closed because you know where the eyes are. That's where the self is. That's where the wakeful state is. When you are half sleepy, little more sleepy, but can still put your hands up, try to touch your eyes. You will touch your nose and you'll think you're touching your eyes. Because the notional point where we are does not stay at the same place. It's the level of awareness, wakefulness that creates the position. When we are sleeping, this very point where we feel we are in the body starts dropping. When we are dreaming, it drops to the throat level. If in a dream, you could suggest to a person who is dreaming, touch your eyes. The person, he will touch his throat and think he is touching his eyes. These experiments have been actually done. In the 60s, I came to the United States and there were a lot of investigations going on the nature of sleep and dreams. I joined one of those courses and we used to have people, subjects sleeping and cameras on top to see rapid eye movement of the eyes and also study what dreams they have, because when the dreams took place, the eyes would move. You could see the camera, you could see outside. The eyes move when you are having a dream. And depending upon the nature of the spectacle you are seeing, what you are seeing in the dream, the eyes move accordingly. Somebody's eyes were fluttering like this, woke up. What are you watching? Oh, I was seeing a waterfall. Somebody's eyes are fluttering this way, horizontally. What are you seeing? I was seeing a tennis match. So you will see that the eyes are moving, physical eyes are actually trying to collaborate with the sequences, which are dream sequences, which are being seen in dreams. It's a big thing. We saw how this happens when you say, touch your eyes. Person dreaming is with a voice. We are waking him up. He touches his throat, touches, think he's touching his eyes. Very interesting things. How our notional place in the body is dependent upon the state of consciousness we are in. Dream state is a lower state of consciousness, it moves downward. Higher state take us up, our eyes go up. Through meditation, we can achieve higher states also and come to that. But the point I'm making now is that if you imagine this is a house you live in, you are sitting in a wakeful state on the sixth floor behind that, and you imagine that you are sitting in the center, starting by saying, where are my ears? Oh, there. Oh, I was sitting in front. I pushed myself back. Oh, I was on the right side. My eyes are here. I'm supposed to be here. Locate yourself in the house, in the sixth floor, at the center. Simple exercise. I am trying to explain it as in detail because people just close their eyes and think it's meditation. Nobody has ever seen anything. People have tried 40, 50 years. Sitting, closing eyes, repeating certain words, a mantra, and we are getting somewhere. I haven't seen anybody. I tried myself, it doesn't work. You have to go to the right place. The right place to concentrate your attention and see something, to open another door inside, is in the center, third eye center, not anywhere else. That is why I'm saying this experiment, I'm saying, imagine you are in the sixth floor, behind the eyes. Once you have imagined it, don't keep on imagining. Where are my ears? Where are my eyes? Then you will remain in the physical body. You won't lose sense of the physical head. But once you have established yourself there, then stay there and forget about it. Where you are, what will happen is a huge space inside. As much as you like, you can see a big garden with your imagination. You can see walls of your house, of your room there. You can decorate your room. You can put nice curtains. You can put beautiful flowers there. You can be 1,000 things which you are doing outside, you can do inside. By doing those things inside, what will happen? You are pulling your attention from outside to inside. The very secret of discovering yourself. So I'm trying to tell you simple methods in plain language, how to just find out who you are, get as close to yourself. What will happen? You will discover that your imaginary self, we sit behind the eyes, is not as imaginary as you thought. Why? Because with that self, which you are imagining, you can see, you can touch, you can taste. I do this experiment all the time. People close their eyes and they are able to have the experience of all sense perceptions. That inner self has all sense perceptions intact, very sharp. Self-perception is much better than you have in a physical body. That's the origin of self-perception, sense-perception that we're using right now in the physical body and thinking, that's imaginary, these are real. Get a reverse experience of it by concentrating your attention on that self. That self has no matter in it, no atoms and molecules in it. It can fly. It can generate an experience of flying right from there. Where can it fly? Anywhere. Can it fly a billion light years away? It can. I'm talking one step ahead, only one step from moving from the physical awareness of our physical body to something that's inside and can be used for going anywhere. very simple exercise. It's a question of practice. When you do go there, you are opening up with another universe, another sky, another place where you are going. It's often been referred to not only as a third eye center, as the tenth door. Because they say that the nine apertures of the body, two eyes, the two ears, the nose, two doors, mouth, two lower apertures, these nine apertures, these nine doors of the body all open outward. And they connect us with the outside experiences. But when you put your attention inside, you are opening an inner door to something that's lying inside, not known to us right now. It's called the tenth door, opening of the tenth door. So simple a device. How to use your imagination, your power of attention, your power of concentrating attention to open the tenth door. When you open your tenth door, you can fly. You can fly anywhere you like. And examine everything you like. Knowledge that comes from there cannot be acquired by any means by sitting in this physical world. No matter how many books you read and how much travel you do. It's amazing. This is just one step of discovery. In addition to our physical body, that there lies within us a form of ours, similar to this, made up by ourselves, which has all sense perceptions. It is the same mind. It thinks the same way. It's alive the same way. It's conscious the same way. It has got all. If soul is consciousness, it's got the soul, it's got the mind, it's got the sense perceptions, all intact. Only thing missing is physical body. Only matter is taken away, physical atoms and molecules have been taken away, rest is intact. Wonderful. Many people think that's a great thing and we have achieved real results of meditation by discovering that we are not the physical body, but something that lives in. If you do it every day, regularly, spend a few hours in that state, more things will happen. What are more things? Like you are using your mind here to remember things. You can remember what happened yesterday, not too much. What happened a year ago, very little. What happened in your childhood, nothing. Memory is very poor sitting in a physical body. Does the memory improve sitting inside? You'll be amazed how much the memory improves when you're inside. You can remember things which you cannot remember sitting outside in the physical body. Not only that, one very strange thing happens. When you remember things inside with that inner self, you discover you can remember what happened 10 years ago, what happened 20 years ago, what happened 200 years ago, what happened 300 years ago. You were not even born. How are you remembering? That is regular meditation, regular going there every day. You will discover that the imaginary self you started off was pre-existing before you were born in this body. Very big thing. You thought you were just imagining something. And suddenly the memory recalls that that one which is sitting inside you, which you thought you just discovered by withdrawing your attention from the physical body, had a longer life. If you spend more time, something even more wonderful will happen. You will be able to project that what is going to happen tomorrow. Just thinking in that body becomes clearer than thinking in this body. And your speculation of what can happen, you say, yeah, after 2 years I can do this, after 5, 20 years. You, when you think in the physical body, you think you'll die by that time. The inner body, you can see further ahead. One big thing happens if you experience that, the fear of death will go away forever. You will know you never die. When this physical body dies, that's alive. That's alive. It's intact. Same mind, same soul, same sense perceptions existing and can manifest in another body. You will also remember that when you remember something 200 years ago, it was an etherical body, but not this body. Past lives can be discovered. Don't have to go to past life regression and somebody telling you, making stories about you. Most people were Antony and Cleopatra or what, never. People tell me, oh, we went to past lives, that gypsy was able to tell us. They were all very important people, well known in history. Those stories, forget, find yourself with your own memory, with your own remembering. Not imagining, remembering. Memory is different from imagining. Anyway, I am telling you, this is a great step to discover so much. And if you can achieve that, your whole attitude of life will change. Your life will change. But what I wanted to share with you was that this is not the end of our journey. We have only found one other form of our life, of ourselves living inside, which generates perceptions and still has the same thinking powers, same life. We can go further. How? Meditate with the inner self, just like you did with this body. If you can withdraw your attention from this body by locating yourself in a notional point, which is the third eye center in the physical head, why can't you do the same thing with the imagined head inside? Little more difficult. Because we are living in this world and thinking there's the only reality, we have made it difficult. But if you practice the first stage and become expert in that, it becomes very easy to go to the next step. Meditate within the head of the inner body and you open another door, much bigger door, much wider experience. You discover your mind. You discover what your mind is. You discover that machine which is making us think here, makes us think there, makes us think without sense perceptions, without physical body. First time we realize perception is not dependent upon sense perception. Perception is a direct experience of the mind. We have spread it out into seeing, touching, tasting, smelling separately to have a wider experience. But perception is not dependent on the organs of sense perceptions, but on the mind. I made a separate study once that when we look at flowers or look at anything, how do you know they are flowers? Is it because we are seeing them? Can the eyes see flowers? No. Eyes can see color, eye can see shape. No more. Eyes can see this, all the different colors and all the shapes. Then what makes them flowers? Not the eyes. The mind. Perception is not dependent upon what we call the sense perceptions. Perception is always created by the mind. Sense perceptions only create a stimuli, something in us, which is color, form, noise, sound, touch, tactile sense. All these are senses. They don't become what we are calling them till the mind comes into the picture. The mind interprets for us. Not only interprets, quietly whispers to us. When we look at the flower, it says flowers. We say flowers. If the mind does not say flower, they don't become flowers. The mind is constantly speaking, sometimes very slow whisper, sometimes loud thoughts. The mind is a constant speaker. We, by the way, as souls, have never spoken. No need. We are listeners. Listening is good enough. For life at all levels, listening is good enough. But we have a device if we want to speak. We use the mind. The mind speaks and we listen. Soul listens. When the soul listens, mind tells the flowers, we say flowers. We say, oh, we had a good experience with our eyes of flowers. Eyes only did a very small part of conveying the color and form. The mind made it flowers and told us flowers, and we experienced flowers. We are an experiencer. the self is the experiencer, and we've got all these facilities around us to have experiences. All experiences are coming because the mind has to speak. We have to listen to become that experience. This is very important. For higher types of meditation, this becomes even more important. I want to touch a little bit on that. How listening is a capacity of the soul, which is more of the self than the mind. Mind is merely attached to it, to create time, space, and thinking and speaking. If listening is our own true sense of perception, sense of experience, if we are experiencers through listening, using the mind to speak up what we are experiencing, using sense perceptions to make up the material for the mind to speak, if this is what the truth is, and we are listeners, essentially, can we listen to ourselves, not to an experience? Very big question. Instead of listening to experiences all the time, oh, I'm seeing flowers, I'm seeing light, I'm seeing this thing, I'm seeing this, can we, if we are listeners, basically, can we listen to our own self? Is there something in our own self that is audible, can be heard, can be listened to? Very big secret revealed by founders of most religions. Our wonderful capacity to listen to our own self. Let us say, our own self is a creative power that creates all experiences, creates our own experience of the self. And we have been now covered by so many other experiences, mind covering us, sense perceptions covering us, body covering us. Does anything still stay which is, can be listened to and should be ourself? Not an experience. Listening to the experiencer. We have ourselves designed something beautiful. That the power that creates everything, when it comes down to the level of a physical body like this, it should be possible to listen to it. Therefore, it emanates something which we call sound. Because our whole concept of listening in the physical body is sound. When we say, oh, listen to something, it has to be sound. It can be called sound, it can be called word, it can be called language, it can be called anything that's audible. No wonder Rig Veda, the oldest Vedic literature we have, describing the creation of this universe, says, in the beginning was the Naad, the sound. All things were created by the sound, audible thing. In the Bible, John's Gospel starts with these words. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Some of my Christian friends come to me and say, have you got a good definition of God? I said, I don't need it, it's given by John. He says, the Word is God. Very clearly, opening verses. Why? How can a word be God? Audible. They have used similar. Islam, same thing. The Bangi Asmani, sound from the sky. Same thing. I studied 11 religions when I was at Harvard University studying economics, but I on the side was studying religion. They refer to this audible thing and the origin of all creation. Why? Because it can be listened to when we are physical bodies. Amazing thing. Now, I give you a little tip for those who do meditation. If you are doing meditation by using a mantra, a repetition of words, which a lot of teachers tell us, you go to teachers of meditation, they will teach you mantra, simran, some words to repeat, and they say, keep on repeating. If you repeat words, you don't get much, because you can't think so as much as you normally do, because you are repeating words, especially with the mind. It helps you have little peace of mind, some calmness, but no inner knowledge, no knowledge of yourself at all. I have never seen anybody finding knowledge of the self by repeating any words of the word, no matter what mantra it is. They are words, spoken words. But if instead of speaking the words, you make the mind speak the words, that means instead of thought, the thinking process should speak those words. So replace thought with those words of mantra, and then listen to those words. Not repeat. Speaking with the mind, listening by yourself. Little shift. Your attention will be on listening to what you're repeating and not repeating only. When we repeat the words, we start with the tongue. It takes time to repeat with the mind. And when we repeat with the mind, tongue also speaks with it. It takes more practice to repeat only with the mind. But still, when we repeat with the mind, we are only repeating. What are we listening to? Other thoughts. Thoughts can come in many channels. People are repeating words and thinking, are we doing it fast enough? Are we doing it slow? Where is that thought coming from? If our mind is occupied in repeating words, where is second talk, commentator coming from? Same mind. Mind has several channels of thinking. You repeat with one channel, the mind starts thinking in the next channel, in a finer voice. You think of the second, combine both of them, it's our third one. These are experiences we have had when you put attention on how the mind works. Therefore, the mind, when you just repeat, speak with the mind, mind is thinking of everything else in the world. Attention is never over there, third eye center. But if you listen to the mind attentively, what you are repeating, the power of listening draws your attention to third eye center. And another thing happens then. I don't know how many of you tried. If you try to listen to the words you repeat, other sounds can be heard inside simultaneously. Other sounds, sometimes it may sound like chirping of crickets, sometimes they sound like little bells, sometimes they sound like thunder, sometimes sound little drums at a distance. All kinds of sounds start coming up just by practicing listening to the sound you are generating by speaking. If you stop listening to the words you are repeating and just become a listener to the sounds existing and concentrate on those sounds, you'll see there are many sounds. Look like they're coming some from the right, from the left, from above. And you narrow it down to the center, you'll hear a sound that is very similar to the sound of a big bell. A big bell, when it rings, dong, dong. If you increase the peal of that bell, instead of dong, dong, it's dong, long peal. That long peal seems to come from the center. You say, is it coming from the top? Yes, down, yes, right, yes. Sound of the self can be heard by becoming a listener of your repeated sounds. When you hear the sound of the self and concentrate your attention on the self, you open the inner door of the second stage faster than any other means I know of. I've tried many, many methods. This particular type of yoga has been called Surt Shabd Yoga. Surt means attention, Shabd means sound, yoga means union with your higher self. That means you can listen to your own self, listen to the sound of the self, fastest way to put your attention on the self and open up further doors inside. excellent. Everything is already there. These are not special people who can do this. We all have the same facility. No matter what country we are born in, no matter what culture we belong to, no matter what religion we belong to, nothing has to be changed. This is not going to be developing a new religion or developing something else. Discovery of your own self. And if you study the scriptures of your own religion carefully, you will find they're all hinting at this. All hinting the kingdom of God is within you. This is the real temple of a living God. This is the real temple. This is the real place where you can find things. They all are saying that. But we don't try to find what is inside. We think reading that is good enough. How can reading something about something be good enough when we want to go there? I can read great literature on the beauty of the paradise island of Hawaii. Beautiful beaches there. I keep on reading. I don't see any beaches. I can imagine anything I like. I can't reach there. We are reading the scriptures, going on reading them, and thinking reading is giving us salvation, reading is giving us... What's giving us? A false sense of believing something which we are not seeing. And if we read too much, a false arrogance. I have read so much, more than you have read. Practice what you are reading. Practice a little part of it. Start with the simple thing, go with it. Go as far as you can. So that is why, if you go within, simple steps, discover where you are in the wakeful state. Meditation can only be done in the human body, in the wakeful state. Nowhere else. Know the form of life and know the state of human being. Why is that? It's an interesting question that we can only do good meditation in one state of consciousness, not even a higher state or a lower state, not in any other form of life, not even if we're angels, we can't do it. How come? How have we been so restricted that we have to be human beings awake to be able to find our own self and know the way? The reason is very simple. As human beings, we have been blessed with ignorance. Ignorance of the future. We don't know what's going to happen tomorrow. If we knew what's going to happen tomorrow, we'll have knowledge. We will not have what is called free will. Today we have free will. The only form of life, only form of life, which has an experience called free will, the ability to make choices, the ability to choose between options presented to it and make one choice or the other and thinking, I am deciding what is going to happen. This is not available in any other state. No birds can do it, no trees can do it, no animals can do it, no angels can do it. Why not angels? Well, they should be able to do it. No higher beings can do it. Why not? They have knowledge. We need ignorance for doing it. Why do we call it ignorance? Because if we knew what's going to happen next second, next minute, next hour, and next part, total part of our life, if we knew, we would discover something very hurtful to us. That everything that we think we are deciding is predecided, predetermined. Big shock will come to us. That we, our thinking process, the use of the brains we make to make decisions that we programmed, that the way we decide what to do is totally pre-programmed. Not events are pre-programmed. The way we make a choice are pre-programmed. Therefore, when we have to make a choice, We use our brain. I remember very interesting incident I like to share with you. There was a student at the university, a friend of mine. We both used to experiment with meditation. It was a good university at the time when there were a couple of professors also trying very hard to find higher consciousness, but through other means, like mushrooms and chemicals. This is the 60s. The two professors, I had a lot of interaction with them, Dr. Richard Hilbert and Dr. Timothy Leary. Richard Hilbert went to India, became Ram Das, Baba Ram Das. And he wrote books, good books also, on his experience with Neem Karoli Baba in India. But we used to have this experiment there. So one student of the university one day called me. He said, "Eureka, I found out we have no free will." I said, "How did you find that out?" He said, "On theological grounds." He said, "We believe in God." He said, "He believed in God. Do you believe in God?" I said, "I also believe in God." So at least we have something to start with, belief in God. And God is defined very clearly. God is omnipresent. He's everywhere. God is omnipotent. He's all the power. And moreover, God is omniscient. He knows everything. Does God know what I am going to decide? Supposing I have to decide whether I have to go left or right. I am sitting here. Does God know beforehand or no? If he doesn't, he is not omniscient. If he does, I have no free will. I do what he is already doing. He found a simple thing. He said, simply on theological grounds, we have no free will because God knows everything beforehand. We are just acting according to God's will. Nothing, we have no real chance. I said, "Please come over to my apartment and let's study this a little further." So I played a little trick on him. When he came, on a tray, I placed a cup of coffee and a cup of tea and an empty cup. When he came, I said, "Oh, by the way, would you like coffee or tea or nothing? I've got all three on this tray. And don't use free will, you don't have any." He was stumped. He said, "Just with coffee, you broke my whole awareness of today." I said, "I am going to prove to you, you say you have no free will. I am going to prove to you, you cannot avoid free will. You say, don't want it, free will. Coffee, free will. Tea, free will. You have no option at this time except to use your free will. Free will is inevitable. How can you say there is no free will? You're experiencing it right here. Tell me how to get out of it." No way to get out of it. Free will is a must. Every time we decide, a man says, "I have no free will," he used free will to say that. He could have said, "I have." We are presented options all our life. And we make choices all our life. The experience of free will is one of the greatest experiences, and only human beings in the wakeful state have it. What's the advantage of this special thing? It's only the experience of free will that can give you the free experience choice of becoming a seeker of the truth and going inside. You wouldn't have this choice at all. Imagine the beauty of being human beings. Imagine the fortunate state we are in, of being human beings awake. The only state where we make choices. The only state where we can become seekers. And when we seek something, we find it. If we don't stop on the way. That's our nature. Seek and you will find. And we can become seekers. Seekers of our own self, when we are human beings and awake. That is why meditation is merely a technique, a technology, a method of discovering ourselves. seeking is the secret. What will happen if you really seek and do nothing else? Just say, I am a seeker, I am sitting somewhere, I am seeking. Do you know what will happen? Everything is predetermined. There must be a pattern already predetermined for that too. There is a predetermined pattern if you are a seeker. You think you are seeking and trying to find something. Won't happen like that. What you are seeking, the means for the seeking will come in front of you by itself. Seeking is not an independent action. Seeking is designed to bring into your capability, your ability to find what you are seeking. You will notice in your life, you seek something, circumstances are created around you to help you to find what you are seeking. Automatically. So what happens when one wants to seek one own self? Just a seeking insight. What happens? By coincidence, by strange circumstances, a person comes into our life who talks about the same thing what we are seeking. It's always happened. If you're not seeking, no, such a person never appears. When you're seeking, somebody comes up. Maybe one person, two persons, maybe many people talking same thing, what you're seeking, and somebody telling you this is the way to do it. Is it just a coincidence or is it also part of a design, predetermined design? If you go inside and see the causal plane of the mind, you will see this is predetermined also. That if you are a seeker, another human being like yourself will appear in your life. We call those human beings as our gurus, as our masters, as our perfect living masters. They appear by themselves. In India they say, when a chela is ready, the guru appears. A Chinese philosopher, Lao Tzu said, when a student is ready, a teacher appears. When a student is fully ready, the teacher disappears. Very interesting couple. The Indian saints have also been saying, chela is ready, guru appears. Nobody has said, when you are ready, you can find one. If you try to find one, you are confused. There are too many teachers, you don't know which one to find. But if you are ready, the teacher appears. This is part of the program we have designed, that when we finish our adventure in the created lands like this planet, we have already made an arrangement to go back home. It's not something new. Created by the same self, the same consciousness that generated this pattern of returning home. We have not been so stupid in our totality that we said, let's get locked out and then remain locked out. We had an arrangement, a key. And this was the key that we kept to be able to return back. Therefore, when such a person comes into our life, he guides us that the truth is inside. A lot of people are around us who are not interested in this. Very few people are interested. Imagine, first of all, life itself, of a human life, is such a small section of total, very small percentage of human beings. Majority of human beings, maybe 95% of human beings are living life as inevitable life. Born, work hard, survive, take care of families, take care of this, take care of your food, and die. Like animals, like plants. Bulk of human beings are living like that. It's a small minority that is saying, I don't belong here. Where do I come from? Those thinkers are not all the human beings, they're very few. And out of those very few, most of them have no idea where we belong to. They just want to go somewhere, escape from here. And for them, heaven is a great escape. Heaven is merely another dimension of experience, and he has still plane, and the first plane we are talking of. They go there. When that is their seeking, they find a teacher who takes them to heaven. But I am talking of a person of your type of curiosity, my type of curiosity, who doesn't want to go to heaven, he wants to go to the origin. Where are we really belonging? Beyond the heavens, beyond the mind, beyond thoughts, beyond individuality, want to find where is the origin of our totality, of our own self. When we come to that seeking, then at that stage, no matter how many teachers have come to us, in this life or previous lives, taking us at different stages, when we are seekers of that, a human being appears in our life, whom we call a perfect living master. All others are masters of the various degrees. Perfect living master, these three words are very important. Why perfect? Because all imperfection, if you study carefully, is created by the mind. Beyond the mind, there is no imperfection. Perfection exists only above the mind. And such a human being is taking us beyond what we think is the mind. We have been identifying ourselves with the mind for several lifetimes. Now we want to separate ourselves from a thinking mind to our own intuitive self, to our own self that knows more than what thoughts can give us. Therefore, the perfection lies there. Why living? Why living master? Why not a dead master who gave all the good teachings to us? Because when we study the teachings of dead masters, we are studying them with our mind. We cannot go beyond the mind by teaching with the mind, by studying with the mind. Why a human being? Why not an angel? Why not a bird? Why not nature? Because all these are all interpreted, what they are saying and telling us, through our mind. They cannot escape our mind. Only a human being like ourselves can say no. Otherwise, the mind will just think what the mind wants. What does the mind want? Let's enjoy this creation a little more. Let's stay here a little more. The mind doesn't want to go anywhere. Therefore, we don't have the way in, except a human being appears. What is the difference between a human being whom we call a perfect living master and ourselves? He is born like us, dies like us, lives like us, eats food like us, falls sick like us, goes to hospital like us, has a karma like us, has destiny like us, everything like us. Then what's the difference? The difference is not in any of these things. The difference is on the awareness of that person. He's aware of the inner self. He's aware of the mental self. He's aware of the spiritual self. He's aware of totality at all times. Supposing somebody has had great experiences, yogic practices, go to the mountain and get experience, come back to teach us. He had experiences, not a perfect living master. Perfect living master is not relating his previous experiences. A perfect living master is in a state of awareness of all these levels, including totality, at all times, even when he's an ordinary human being sitting with us. Big difference. Therefore, when a perfect living master speaks, he's not speaking for remembering what he saw or what he read. He's speaking from where he is. That's the only difference. The difference is in the awareness of a perfect living master and ourselves. Perfect living master is aware of all states that which we possibly can be in. Why can't we be in that state also? We can be. But the way we have experiencing reality is an important point. How do we experience what is real? Reality can only be experienced if we cut off all other forms of awareness. How do dreams become real? When you go to dream, they look real because we are not awake. Suppose we were always awake and also having a dream, it will never become real. Daydreaming, it will be a daydream. A dream becomes real because we shut off the awareness of the wakeful state. The wakeful state becomes real because we shut off the dream and we shut off any higher awareness. The higher awareness, when we become unaware of the body, become the only reality. This becomes dreamlike. That's the only one reality. We shut off everything else. Our whole method of creating an experience we call real is by shutting off all other awarenesses except one level. And how do we verify this is real? By using the means of that very level, not another level. We have no access to the other levels to examine the reality of any level. I want to know, is this table real? Is this glass of water real sitting on this table? What's my method of finding the reality? I can touch it. Taste it. Very good. Tastes good. I can touch it, see it. All sense perceptions are confirming it's real. Now let me say, supposing I am having a dream, I see the same table in the dream, I see the same glass in the dream, and I want to say, is it real? And I pick up the glass. I can pick it up, I can touch it, I can feel it, I can drink it, taste the same like it tasted now. I said it's real. And I wake up. There was no glass. It was not real. How did I think it was real? Because I was testing reality with perceptions at the same level, not wakefulness. It became unreal only when I woke up and remained real because the method I was using for checking reality were a combination of sense perceptions at the same level. That's what we are doing here. All our reality of this universe is coming by touching with different sense perceptions. I can see it, I can touch it, I can smell it, real. And when we wake up, they all disappear. Except one thing does not disappear. When we have a taste of water in the dream and wake up, the taste of water is still in my mouth. That means taste was real, not the water. There used to be a very favorite disciple of Mahatma Gandhi, then she became a big dancer. And I, one of my jobs, was invited to their dance school, and she asked me the interpretation of certain words they use in the Indian scriptures. They say this world is Maya. The word Maya is used. Translated into English, illusion. Very bad translation. She said, if this world is illusion, why should it look real to us? Supposing we cast a shadow on the wall, we know it's a shadow. It doesn't become real. If this world is like a shadow, like they say, then it should be a shadow. Why are we taking it as real? Why is it being called Maya or illusion? So explain to her that the word Maya does not mean illusion in the sense you are taking. It's not a shadow. What is Maya? I explained to her. You are having a cup of tea. I said, pick up your cup of tea and taste it. Did you pick up the cup? Yes, I did. It's real. It's not illusion. Did you pick up? Sorry, I think. This thing can supersede me. Technology supersedes us. I said, if you taste the tea, did you actually taste the tea? She said, yes. I said, how can it be unreal? How can you call it illusion? You have touched the cup, you've tasted the tea. How can you call it illusion? That's not the root meaning of the word Maya. That you are not having any real experience, all shadows. Not at all. Your experiences are absolutely real. No illusion. I tell you what the illusion is. Because the experience is real, you think the cup is real. You think the tea is real. That's not. Illusion is very different. You are taking the objects, which are part of the experience, as real. Where the experience is real and not the objects. Has a deep meaning of Maya. Then I explained the same thing like I did now, that if you have a dream, in the dream you have tasted something good. You wake up, the taste is still there. The taste was not unreal. The object which you thought created the taste was not real. Taste created the object and not the object creating the taste. We have misplaced the cause or the effect and the effect for the cause. We say the world exists, therefore we see it. The truth is we see it and therefore the world exists. We have just misplaced these two, and that's what the word Maya says, that the experience is being considered as illusion and not the objects that are created. We think objects create experience, the truth is experience creates objects. And dream is a good example, and this is also a dream. Therefore, sometimes these various levels of awareness are described as levels of wakefulness. We awake to a higher level and discover, oh, that was not real what we saw. The experiences were real. Experiences are always real. The experience is always real. But not what we think are the objects of experience. Those, when we wake up, they disappear. Higher we wake up, they more disappear. Eventually, everything disappears. They are all created except the experiencer, whom we call the self. The self continues to be the experiencer, and the most beautiful part, the self never changes, no matter what your level of consciousness is. Whether you are total, only one, same self is being experienced in us today, right inside. In the dream, you have a dream body, not this body, same self. Self never changes, everything else changes. Therefore, if you want to define reality as that what does not change, the only thing that never changes, no matter what, is the self, and everything else changes. You want to find something real, find yourself. Go within yourself and find the true self. Hiding inside this so-called cover of a self. These are very beautiful covers. Very beautiful experience they give us. Physical body, wonderful cup. Inner body, sense perceptions, wonderful cup. Mind thinking, mind, wonderful cover. Individuated soul, wonderful cover. Total soul, our true self, same self having all these experiences. Can you imagine? All this is open to us when we are human beings and seekers. I congratulate all of you for being seekers of the same truth that I am seeking. We are co-travelers of the same path. I shared these experiences with you, shared this information with you, because I was very lucky to find a human being who was a perfect living master. You see his photo here. His name was Dur Baraj Baba Savan Singh. Great master, we call him great master. All I have shared with you is the result of his teachings. All is the result of just following what he said. I give all the credit for all my experience to him, to one man, that he could transform not only my life, everybody's life. You want to get away from the ups and downs of this life, use one little tip of mine. Instead of feeling you are living in this body and going through the ups and downs of this body, from this moment start thinking you are living inside the body, behind the eyes, and watching this life, watching this drama going on. There's so many actors you will meet, your relatives, husbands, wives, children, parents, business people, all actors on the stage. and all acting their part according to their own script of what they are supposed to be doing and saying, you sit there and watch. Take it easy, relaxed chair and sit and watch the show. All the actors are acting, including one which is called by your own name. Your body is also one of those actors. Don't start thinking, I'm the body, I'm watching a show. Then you are in trouble. You have to separate yourself. And the actor in whose body you are sitting. I'll tell you, we go and see a movie. It's on the screen. And we see it from an audience. Show is taking place. We see drama on the stage. We're sitting further away from it. Tragedy takes place there. People kill each other on the show, on the movies, and in this. We don't move from our chair. We know it's a show going on. We can become alert. We can come on the edge of the chair. Oh, what will happen next? We can say that. But you don't leave the chair and run to the stage. Do the same thing here. Sit there and get alarmed if something is happening, but don't leave the chair. Keep sitting on the chair and watch the show. All you have done is very simple. Show was taking place. Instead of being so far away in the audience, you said, let me go close. You came close to the audience. You said, let me get into one of the characters and see more closely. You jumped into the head of one character who you are thinking is yourself. You are not the self, that's one actor. You are sitting in the head of one actor. Watch the show from there. See your life completely change from tomorrow. Thank you very much for your very patient listening. And I'll be very happy to see many of you who come for the first time and wanted some personal time. So at about 3 o'clock, I'll come and talk to you, answer some questions if you have, and then spend a little time with those who have come for the first time and give them personal time for them. Thank you for your very patient listening. Blessings to you.